welcome you to Grace Community Church again, and we're continuing our study in 2 Peter chapter 2. Last Sunday, I had a little problem with the computer, but nevertheless, we got through it, so I'm going to back up just a little bit so I can show it on the screen. And in 2 Peter chapter 2, remember it says, "For God spared not the angels that sinned in the days of Noah." Well, we went back to Genesis chapter 6. It says, "And it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, the daughters were born unto them." Those are the sons of God that came down to earth. And we looked at several verses, especially in the book of Job, that tells us that the phrase, the sons of God, are actually angels. So there were angels that came down to the earth. They took upon them daughters that were born unto the men on the earth, and they took them as they saw fit, and they had sexual relations with them. And that tells us a lot about angels, doesn't it? What they can do, what they're able to do, and so forth. And then, of course, we see that there were great giants in the earth in those days. Chapter 6, 4 to 5 in Genesis, there were giants in the earth in those days. And also after that, when the sons of God came unto the daughters of men, they bare children to them. The same became mighty men of old, men of renown. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Now, I think there are some places on the earth right now where that is getting very close, if that's the way it is. The every imagination and thoughts of the heart of man are evil continually. See some of the things that are happening over in the Middle East and so forth, and it makes you feel that God is going to intervene very soon because of the things that are happening. And see, with the wickedness of man was great in the earth, primarily in this particular passage, is because of the angels that sinned, came down to earth, had relationships with the daughters, with men on the earth, men, women on the earth. And of course, the result was extensive wickedness on the earth, the giants in the earth, and the wickedness of man was great. And I believe we will see that same thing happening again. Remember in Matthew, when the Lord Jesus was talking to the 12, especially in Matthew 24, 25, and he talks about the tribulation period, the end time, what they will be going through. And even then, he says, "So as it was in the days of Noah, shall it be at the second coming of the Son of Man." And we see this just prior to the flood here in Genesis, what took place. And I think in the tribulation period, you're going to see the same thing once again. There's going to be angels that come down to the earth, and the result will be really wickedness on the earth once again. Not to say that there is wickedness on the earth today. There certainly is. But we're not even in the tribulation period yet. And that's going to happen in the tribulation period. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 6 is kind of where we, I guess we mentioned it, but it says, "And turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an example unto those that after should live ungodly." Why is Peter going through all of these historical facts concerning ungodly men? Because he is showing those that he is writing to, those of the dispersion, what is coming next. And as far as Peter is concerned, the tribulation period is coming and the second coming of Christ. And he is explaining to the things that are going to take place primarily in the tribulation period, but that they ought to watch out for. Now, as far as they were concerned, they knew nothing concerning the rapture. They knew nothing of the age of grace. It was all a mystery. It was all a secret hid in God. And so even though that Peter was living now after the Apostle Paul was saved, Peter did understand a few things, I think, especially about the cross, concerning the gospel that was given to the Apostle Paul, being the apostle to the Gentiles. However, many of those believers there were saved under the kingdom program, and they were looking for that thousand-year reign, the kingdom. Now, I'm going to go back just a little bit here, if I can. See how to do it here. This is what I wanted to show you last week. And there was some time ago we saw this and from we was going through 1 Peter. But we see in 2 Peter 2 here that these angels that sinned, that came down to earth, are reserved unto judgment, and they are in Tartarus. Now, the English word that you have in your Bible, it says hell. They were cast down to hell. Well, that particular word hell is translated from the Greek word Tartarus or Tartarol. And so we must understand what that means. That particular word is only used one time in all of Scripture. And that's where it's at in 2 Peter here. Tartarus. Well, what is Tartarus? Where is Tartarus? Well, as far as we can understand, just going to show you here on the chart here, the unseen world. Now, we have it in the Old Testament with the Hebrew word Sheol right there. And in the New Testament, it's translated Hades. Now, you don't see it. It's not called the unseen world, but in the Old Testament, it's called hell. It's called the grave. In the New Testament word Hades, usually it's translated into the word hell. Now, when we think of hell, we think of a place where people go, where there's fire and there's burning and so forth. Well, now notice up here it says before Calvary, before the cross. I don't know what that thing is popping up down there, but anyway. This is all before Calvary. Now, I have here the earth, but this is actually the unknown world right here. It's all in the center of the earth. Okay, all in the center. We know the center of the earth is molten, and it's extremely hot, as if fire and so forth in the center of the earth. But anyway, this is the center of the earth. Now, before Calvary, when anyone was saved before the cross, they went to paradise in the center of the earth, in Abraham's bosom, same place. And a good reference for that, of course, is in Luke 16, the rich man and Lazarus and so forth. And we know from the story in Luke 16, the rich man and Lazarus, that there was a great gulf between these two. Place of torments. That's the place that is in paradise also, where the unsaved go. They went. Where they're still there. And we know there's a great gulf in between. Abraham's bosom, the paradise here, is no longer there because of the cross. They could not, these saved people could not go to heaven because the payment had not been paid for sin yet. The Lord Jesus Christ had not died on the cross of Calvary and finished his work and ascended into the heavens. So there was a place they went to Abraham's bosom. But now in Ephesians 4, we looked at that when we were back, we was in Peter, 1 Peter. When the Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross of Calvary, where did he go? Where was he for 3 days before he resurrected? He went to the center of the earth, it says. He went down to the center of the earth. What is that down there? I don't know. But anyway, distracted me. Got a bug popping up down in there. Anyway, he went to the center of the earth and preached to the spirits in prison. Now, it is commonly thought that the spirits in prison that he preached to in the center of the earth was right here, Tartarus, these angels that sinned way back in Genesis 6. Now, it says spirits in prison there. And I'm not 100% convinced that that's who he preached to, but anyway, it doesn't make any difference. This was before Calvary. So after the cross, paradise is no longer. We have the place of torment. Anybody that is unsaved today and dies goes to the place of torment. And we still have this place here, Tartarus, which Peter talks about in 2 Peter chapter 2 here, where the angels that sinned back in Genesis are chained right here in everlasting darkness. They cannot get out, and they are reserved unto judgment. Now, when that judgment is, I don't know for sure. It could be at the second coming of Christ, but I think more likely that's the end of the thousand-year reign, when there's judgment upon all unbelievers that particular time. But anyway, they are chained in everlasting darkness right now for judgment in the future. So, just a little bit more on this chart here. The unsaved dead, they go to place of torments. They always have, until we get to Revelation chapter 20. We see there, we see the hell that we think of, the lake of fire, and it is talked about, and we know at the end of the thousand-year reign, we have the great white throne judgment, and that is when all the saved from all the ages stand before the throne of God and are judged by the Lord Jesus Christ. And what happens to them, Revelation 20 tells us, they are cast into the lake of fire that was prepared for the devil and his angels. So in the very end, we see the devil, the and possibly the spirits in prison here, the angels, and all those that have not accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, all the way from Adam all the way on, will be cast into the lake of fire right here. Right now it's unoccupied, but that's what's going to happen at the end of the tribulation period, and I think some at the end of the thousand-year reign. So that gives us a little idea what Peter is thinking about. Now, when he goes through all these references that we have in 2 Peter, when he writes, he's bringing up several stories of the Old Testament, things that have happened, taken place, primarily to the nation of Israel. That's who Peter is talking to. He's talking to Jewish believers primarily. You see, and then he goes on and he says, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes. Now he's going over these judgments that the Lord has pronounced or put on the nation of Israel because of their unbelief, because of their rejection of the truth. And remember when the nation of Israel, after coming across the Red Sea, going into Saudi Arabia there and coming up, going to the land of Canaan, they got up to Jordan, the what is now the land of Jordan there, and the Jordan River. Remember, they crossed the Jordan River. Not only did the Lord Jesus part the waters of the Red Sea that they came across, he also stopped the waters from flowing on the Jordan River so they could go into the land of Canaan. And we kind of forget about that sometimes, but that's what happened. And what did the Lord tell the nation of Israel when they went into the land of Canaan? To wipe out all these groups of people, the Amorites, the Gadites, the all kinds of ites, Canaanites. There were several of them in that land of Canaan, but because of their sinfulness, their idolatry, these groups of people, the Lord told the nation of Israel to go in and wipe them all out. And that's what was happening here. And the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah were right, they think, they were that. If you look it up and find out where the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah are at or were at, they're right next to the Jordan River, someplace right in that area. But they have never found any remains of Sodom and Gomorrah until, I want to say, just the last couple years. When we were on a cruise into the Caribbean with Kurt Christ and so forth, when we were going through the scriptures every night and so forth, we had a couple that were on that cruise that were, I don't know if I'd call them archaeologists, but anyway, they were searching that area by Jordan there. They would go over there every year and spend, I think, 8-10 weeks over there and dig out all kinds of stuff. And they believed that they had found now these cities, Sodom and Gomorrah. So I don't know. They think anyway. Not proof, but it's very possible. But the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah was such, it was so great that there was hardly nothing left. And we remember the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. Let's see here. The cities were so great, if I can get this Remember Lot? Lot was Abraham's nephew. Now, years ago, before this took place with Sodom and Gomorrah, Abraham's nephew, Lot, went with Abraham down into Egypt for, I don't know, several reasons. But anyway, they went down into Egypt. Well, Lot, being a young man at that particular time, and Egypt being full of idolatry and all kinds of sin taking place in Egypt, Lot saw all that, and he got involved in that, and he really wanted to be involved in all this. Even though Lot was a saved man, now notice what happens. 2 Peter 2, 7 through 9, and delivered just Lot, in other words, he's a saved man, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. Now, after Abraham and Lot were down in Egypt, they went back north, and Lot decided he was going to camp, he was going to stay in the land of, what is it, Jordan. Now, so, but he got involved in that lifestyle, ungodly lifestyle of Egypt, and he just couldn't get away from it. So what did he do? He moved from Jordan and went into the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. And that's where he was living, because he wanted this ungodly relationship and the sexual sins and all this that was taking place. Lot got involved in that, even though he was a just man, like it says here. He says, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that righteous man, Lot, dwelling among them in seeing and hearing, vexed, which means wearing down his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. So Lot and his family really got involved in the sin that was taking place in Sodom and Gomorrah. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations. Isn't that interesting how the last part of that verse is? The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations, and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. Now, as the story goes on, of course, the Lord wanted Lot to leave Sodom and Gomorrah because he was going to destroy those cities because of their sinfulness. Well, Lot was kind of between a rock and a hard place. He didn't want to leave. His family was still there. And he was so involved in what was going on in Sodom and Gomorrah that angels came and literally took him by the hand and led him out of the cities to get him to go. And there's more to the story. There were two angels that came to Lot prior to this that was happening. And the two angels came, and they were informed in the form of human beings, men, and Lot invites them into his house, makes a great big meal for him, and these angels, they came as men, they ate with them, and so forth. And in the meantime, while these two angels were in Lot's house eating, men from the city of Sodom came to Lot's house, and they saw these men come in. And they came to Lot's house. Lot goes to the door. And these men, what did they come for? They wanted to have sexual relationships with these two men that they saw come into Lot's house. That's how bad this city was. Well, anyway, as it didn't happen. And anyway, the Lord works through these angels, and he brings Lot out of the city. And we know the story that the Lot and his wife left the city, and he had to leave part of his other family, the rest of his family there. But as soon as they got away from the city, and what did he tell them? He says, do not look back. And when they left the city, got way away from the city a little ways, God sent fire from heaven down and destroyed the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. Now there were, as history tells us, there were other cities also that were destroyed, but it's primarily Sodom and Gomorrah where Lot was at. So the Lord brought Lot out of Sodom, and his wife, and when they were a ways away, of course, his wife wanted to look and see what was happening to the city, so she turned around and looked. What happened to her? She turns into a pillar of salt. So, you know, the judgment of God is severe. But he also, but he always gives us warning. He gives warning beforehand. Do not do this, or do what I say. And if you don't, there's judgment. Now, Peter is going through this to these believers, warning them of what has taken place, of all these ungodly people that you're going to be involved with, especially during the tribulation period and what is about to take place here. And stay strong. Remember in First Peter, he was talking to them to stand and take a stand. Stay strong as a believer. Do not get involved with these people. In verse 10 and 11 it says, "But chiefly them that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise government. Presumptuous," which means boldness, are they. They are very bold, these men, these people that are involved in all these sinful acts. "Self-willed. They are not afraid to speak evil of dignities. Whereas angels, which are greater in power and might, bring not really an accusation against them before the Lord." That's kind of interesting statement there. Even though the angels, they're greater than men as far as their creation, they're greater in power and might than we are. But they are not accusing these brethren, these sinful people before the Lord, even though they could if they wanted to. "But these, as natural brute beasts, made to be taken and destroyed." That's interesting, isn't it? These natural brute beasts, these men, these people, made to be taken and destroyed. You know, all this is what is going on even in the Old Testament, what happened, and also what's going on the earth today. ISIS and so forth, all over there in the Middle East, and what they're doing to Christians, beheading them, killing them. It's just, you can't understand how people can do that. Well, when your motivation is self-willed from the flesh and Satan behind it too, you can. That's why they do it. And here he calls a natural brute beast, made to be taken and destroyed. Even though that these men, and even today, are involved in these sinful acts, they're part of, and it's hard maybe to understand, but they are part of the overall plan of God. They're not out of control. They are in control. God is controlling everything on the earth. Every little thing that takes place, God is in control. Remember, he is sovereign. We don't understand it all, but yet the scripture tells us this, so we need to believe it by faith, even though we don't understand it. You know, that's the problem with a lot of people. They won't believe it until they understand it. Well, there are things in scripture that we know are true. Do we understand it? For instance, the Trinity. You know, the word Trinity is never found in scripture. It's not in scripture. But we know there's a Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. All the way from Genesis chapter 1, all the way through the scriptures, it talks about the Trinity, 3 in 1. Do we understand it? How many here understand the Trinity? That's pretty tough, you know? But do we believe it? Of course we believe it, you know? Do we understand exactly how Christ's death on the cross can pay for our sin and that God can save us? There are a lot of things we don't understand in the scriptures, but we take it by faith. We believe it because of God. God says it is true. Okay, the same thing here. These brute beasts made to be taken and destroyed speak evil of things they understand not. And that's pretty obvious. They don't understand what they're doing. They don't understand why they're doing it. They don't understand the belief of Christians. You know, those that are involved in ISIS and so forth, the other religions of the world, they don't understand Christianity. They think we're wackos. You know, we follow that blood religion, you know, that Christ died on the cross, shed his blood, that bloody religion. Why do you follow that? You really actually believe that? I've heard people say that. They don't understand it. Why don't they? Because they don't have the Spirit of God within them. And it's the Holy Spirit that dwells within us as believers today. It is the Holy Spirit that gives us that faith that we can believe in the Scriptures. We have faith in the Scriptures. And the more we study it, the more we find out that it is true, what God says. Okay, the last part of this verse is, and shall receive the reward of unrighteousness, as they that count it pleasure to riot in the day. Spots they are and blemishes, supporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you. They're getting so involved. They get involved with believers, groups of believers, so they can take them down. Let's see. Here's David in Psalms. He talks about his enemies. He says, until I went into the sanctuary of God, then I understood their end. So remember Psalm, and if you go back here and in Psalms, David speaks a lot of times about his enemies. And he talks to God and he says, man, when are you going to do something about these enemies of ours? You know, what? I have enemies. You know, God, where are you at? What's going to happen to these enemies? Well, he's here. He says, until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I their end, the destruction. So when we read the Scriptures, we understand that those people that are involved in these atrocious acts, what is their end? Destruction. Forever in the lake of fire. However, they do have a chance to live in all eternity with the Lord Jesus Christ if they believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, no matter what they did. How are they brought into desolation? As in a moment, they are utterly consumed with terrors. I think we're going to stop right there. We just have a couple minutes left before we get into another event, what took place in the Old Testament. The story of Balaam. Oh, that's an interesting story. See what happens there. Balaam, a prophet in the Old Testament, how he got involved in things he shouldn't have been, trying to destroy the nation of Israel and so forth. And that's kind of a longer story. So I think we're going to stop right there. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you once again for this opportunity of learning from your word. And we just thank you so much that the Holy Spirit has come down and has sealed us, dwells within us, and helps us to understand your word, that we may know and understand it, that we might be a testimony for you, that others might come to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. This we ask in your precious name. Amen.